जिंदा है तू जिंदगी ये जीत में यकीन कर अगर कहीं है स्वर्ग तो उतार ला जमीन पर तू जिंदा है तू जिंदगी ये जीत में यकीन कर अगर कहीं है स्वर्ग तो उतार ला जमीन पर तू जिंदा है। ये गम के और चार दिन सितम के और चार दिन ये दिन भी जाएंगे गुजर गुजर गए हजार दिन ये गम के और चार दिन सितम के और चार दिन ये दिन भी जाएंगे गुजर गुजर गए हजार दिन
कभी तो होगी इस चमन पे भी बहार की नजर
अगर कहीं है स्वर्ग तो उतार ला जमीन पर तू जिंदा है तू जिंदगी की जीत में यकीन कर अगर कहीं
कैसे समाज में रहते हैं जहाँ पर इंसान को अपना ही जीवन जीने की आजादी नहीं है
वुमेन बीइंग रेप्ड एंड चिल्ड्रन बीइंग किल्ड एंड हाउ इनसेंसिटिव आवर सोसाइटी हैज बिकम
पीपल आर नॉट रॉन्ग व्हाट इज रॉन्ग इज देयर रिलीजन व्हाट इज रॉन्ग इज देयर सोशल आइडियोलॉजी
नाउ द पॉइंट इज डू वी वांट टू सस्टेन इंस्टीट्यूशंस इन व्हिच इक्वालिटी एंड लिबर्टी कैन नॉट बी सस्टेन
एक समय था जब गरीबी से लड़ने की जरूरत थी अब वो समय आया है जब सांप्रदायिकता से लड़ने की जरूरत है
Struggle against communalism can be properly waged by young people like you if you constantly interact with people around you.
People are having so much of myths regarding Muslim community.
हमारे खेलों तक पे असर देखने को मिलता है अपने निजी स्वार्थों के लिए निजी लाभ के लिए वो पूरे शहर का पूरे समाज का माहौल बिल्कुल खराब कर देता
है. I refuse to believe that a majority of our media is spreading hate or prejudice.
आपस में इस तरह की चीजें चलती रहे समाज बटा रहे उनको रोटियां सेकने का जो मौका मिलता रहे
जनरली द पीपल हु परपेचुएट दीज क्राइम्स दे गेट अवे विदाउट गेटिंग एनी पनिशमेंट
सपोज सच अ कार्नेज ब्रेक्स आउट अराउंड यू व्हाट आर यू गोइंग टू डू
डोंट फॉरगेट अफगानिस्तान डोंट फॉरगेट तालिबान डोंट फॉरगेट दैट दीज आर द कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस ऑफ ग्रेट इंटरनल स्ट्राइफ प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय द सेम फैक्टर्स एट वर्क इन आवर पार्ट ऑफ द वर्ल्ड Don't forget that.
Fascism in India will not come in the form in which it has come in Europe. Fascism in India will come in the form of communism.
Even if not in the short run, I'm quite optimistic in the long run it will be defeated. It has to be defeated because it cannot survive. Because history has not been shaped like this. And history will come to the rescue of the future of a great nation like India.
In order to understand the issue of Dalit, we have to understand the Hindu social structure or Hindu social order. Because apart from many other reasons, the problem of low caste in India, particularly the Dalits or untouchables, is closely related with the caste system or Hindu social organization. And therefore, we need to understand that in its traditional form. The caste system involved division of people into social groups. What are called caste or subcaste or jatis. Now there is nothing wrong with that. If you look at the societies all over the world, there has been a division on one basis or another. Even Plato talks about the classes. But this division of people into social groups is based on the allocation and assignment of rights and occupations. The assignment and allocation of rights between the caste, and I am not going into detail because you know the caste system. Between the four castes in the traditional caste system, for example, the economic right, the civic right, the religious right, the cultural rights and political rights. They are distributed by across the caste group but determined by birth. The occupations are determined, the civic rights are determined, the religious rights are determined, the cultural rights are determined. Now there is also nothing wrong in that. I mean, in society you find occupational groups. Some groups are doing some occupation, others are doing other occupation, and they are being named. There were certain groups which have some rights, additional rights, feudal lord has more right in Europe vis-a-vis the serf and the slave. But what is important here is the distribution is unequal in nature. That is the key thing of the caste system. That some caste have more right and some caste have no rights. So the caste system is, as a social and economic organization and as a cultural organization, is based on the principle of inequality. It is not only unequal distribution of the rights, but it is also hierarchical division of the rights. Down to the untouchable or Dalit, the rights goes down and the duties increases. For example, untouchable don't have a right to property. If you read Manusmriti carefully, they don't have right to property, they don't have right to accumulate wealth, they don't have right to education, they don't have right to trade, they don't have right to military, they don't have cultural rights. If you go to Tamil Nadu and many other parts, there are still very indirect restriction on using of umbrella, using of bicycle, using of ornament, using of certain type of clothes. That is cultural rights. Of course, restriction on entry to the temple, religious right is certainly denied to them. So what you discover is that some castes are given an overwhelming right, particularly the Brahmin at the top of the caste hierarchy, and untouchable at the bottom have no rights. The caste in between also suffer from lack of access to some rights. There is a fourth element in which that you must understand, and that is important, that not only the Hindu social order divide the people into caste or social group, fix their occupation, economic, civics, political, cultural and religious rights, and fixed it in an unequal manner and hierarchical manner, so that some have more and some have less, but it also provides for a mechanism of enforcement. That is a key thing. It provides what sociologists would call social ostracism. And somebody disobeys this, violates the customary rules of the caste system, there is a mechanism of penalties and punishment. It's very clearly written in Manusmriti, and you find it even today. A couple being killed by the parents in full view of the villager for the reason is that the girl decided to marry a low caste person. So the punishment is to kill. There is a very detailed discussion in the Manusmriti that if untouchable listen to Vedas, a very hot liquid of the glass, melted glass should be poured in his ear, or if he utters the Ved mantra, his lips should be cut. So physical punishments are prescribed in the Hindu social order to enforce the system. Last point that you must need to understand in the context of the current discussion is that there is not only a mechanism, but there is a philosophical justification in Hindu religious philosophy. That is the key thing. There comes the interconnection between the caste system and Hindu religious philosophy. It's caste system is the organized social organization of the Hindus. But it also get in support, philosophical justification and support. And therefore it became a very strong and very stubborn institutions. So theory of karma, rebirth, provide justification to the caste system. What is the theory of karma in Hinduism? Theory of karma in Hinduism talks about three worlds, past, present and the current. And it provides that if untouchable is suffering from exploitation and poverty, it is because he must have done something wrong in his past birth. What is the solution? He is asked that he should continue to work for high caste under that situation so that in the next birth he get a better life. So that is important, that there is a link between caste system and Hindu religion. Why Dalit? Because caste system is a social organization and everybody suffers except the caste at the top of the hierarchy. Every caste suffers in one way or other. But the Dalit or untouchable suffer the most, and that is why the issue of Dalit. Because at least the 3-4 castes on the top of the untouchables have some access to sources of income and some right. Vishyas have a right to trade, Shudras have a right to agriculture, Kshatriyas have a right to military, Brahmins have a right to education and others. So they have some source of income and some cultural and civic right. Untouchable do not have any right. It is very explicitly mentioned in the Manusmriti that the only job of untouchable to serve the caste above them. If you want to compare the situation of untouchable with slave, you must understand that the right to education and right to military was not denied to slave. I was discussing with, there was a seminar on education and exclusion a couple of days before, and people from South Africa came. Right to education was not denied to them. They could start their school. Here is an untouchable caste, where no right to property, no right to business, no right to trade, no right to agriculture, no right to education, which other castes do not suffer. And what is untouchability? Untouchability is, well, if you have to understand the cultural fascism clearly, we have to understand some of these characteristics, that the untouchables are polluting the inferior human being as against the Brahmin, which are superior human being. And they being the polluting caste, inferior groups, they ought to be living separately. So there is a residential segregation, social segregation. The social and physical intercourse with them is considered to be polluting. Therefore, even today, where 70% of the untouchable live, all the residences are separate. I am yet to see in a village where the locality of untouchable and the high caste are intermixed. Never. So, residential segregation, social segregation, because of untouchability, touch me notism, unapproachability, don't approach, go closer to untouchable, he is polluting. Unseeability, in the days of Peshwas, Brahmin kings in Maharashtra, even untouchable to see untouchable was supposed to be very bad. And you know the harsh life of untouchables, that was when you had a Brahmin king and caste system put into practice, the untouchable situation was pathetic in Peshwa period. They were not allowed to walk on the road in the afternoon because the shadow gate lengthened and Brahmin get polluting, so they were only allowed to move on the road before 1 o'clock. If they split on the road would get polluted, and if somebody touch it, he will get polluted. So they were asked to hang a pot around their neck so that they can split in the pot. Impression laid by their walking also polluted high caste, so they were asked to tie a broom behind. That was the degradation and slavery of the untouchable during Peshwas. The impact of the caste system has been very devastating on them. If you want to see today their status, despite the fact that there are 50 years of independence, where do they stand? At all India level, about 65% of them are wage labor in rural area. So only 19% of them have land now. So traditional restriction of ownership of land continues. In state like Punjab, 95% of the scheduled castes are landless and near landless. Why? A act was passed in 1907 that untouchable don't have a traditional right to ownership of land. So formally the act was passed. From 1901 to 1946, caste system put into practice in the formal law. So even today, 70%, 80%, 90%, depending on the region, they don't have access to land. Access to capital, only 10% of them have business in rural area. Only 24% of them have business in urban areas. 30% of them casual labor in urban area. Literacy rate is 37% as against 57% among the others. If they have a 10% of them do some business in rural area and about 20% in urban area, the level of poverty among the self-employed in agriculture and non-agriculture is in the range of 35% to 40%. There is a discrimination in employment. The unemployment rate of the scheduled castes are twice the unemployment rate of others. As a result, the poverty level among the scheduled castes today, 93-94, I am giving because 99 figures are not reliable, about half of them are poor in rural and urban area, vis-a-vis as compared to the others where the poverty level is just 20%. So they are almost 30 years behind other compared to the poverty level. Anti-Untouchability Act was passed, which was renamed in 1979 as a Civil Rights Act. What does that act say? That all public places where there are traditional restriction for the scheduled castes, they will have access now. And any opposition by the high caste is subject to punishment. So they have access to temple, they have access to public well, they have access to public tap, they have access to public road, they have access to public water bodies under the act, which they did not have. We had to pass an act because Hindu society did not allow them to have an access to public temple, entry to the temple. That act was not good enough. So government has to pass another act. That is called Prevention of Atrocities Against Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe in 86. And there are 23 behavior of high caste which are considered to be offensive, which are considered to be against the law. The Commission for Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe brings out the statistic on practice of untouchability and atrocity annually. That report is presented in the parliament, supposed to be discussed, but for last 10 years it is not being discussed. The large majority of the village, they don't have entry to the temple, they don't have entry to, there is a discrimination at the tap water, or they have a separate well or separate tap. There are restrictions at time to use public places. You cannot have a marriage procession on a horse through the public road. Discrimination in education. Although the constitution recognizes equality and denies discrimination based on caste, but the high caste people in the villages, their behavior is continued to be controlled by the traditional norms of the caste system. So they don't understand why this concept of equality is coming up in the villages. People are not wrong. What is wrong is their religion. What is wrong is their social ideology. So they continue to oppose, and they also continue to use physical violence, because that is the way that is being taught in the religious manusmriti or social doctrine. This is not to say that there is no change. There is a significant change also. Poverty, which was 70% in early 50s, has gone down to 50%. There is access to education. The literacy rate has jumped from 10% to 37%. Because of the reservation policy, you see large number of them into government jobs, into educational institutions. So there is a change because of the reservation policy and Indian constitutions making special provision, economic program. But nevertheless, the change has been very slow, and they continue to suffer, and the disparity between them and the high caste continued to be there. If you go back to the ancient India, I would say Buddhism was the first revolt or opposition to the social system of the Hindus and religious aspect of the Hindus, some of the religious aspect of Hinduism also. So Buddha talk about equality, discard the concept of rituals and sacrifice and God and karma theory based on soul and past deed and all that, and talk about certain principle of social behavior. Jainism, Charvaka, for example. So there has been a tradition in ancient India to oppose the Hindu social order and certain aspect of religious principles which lend support to the caste system. In the medieval period, later medieval period, you have the Bhakti movement. You have Meera, you have Namdev, you have Guru Nanak, you have several writers. They were basically writers, Bhakti writers. You have in Orissa, Shudra Munis, in Maharashtra, Tukaram. And these were all OBC, backward caste, for example, Meera. Meera is nothing but a revolt against feudal system and gender discrimination. And when the time passed, how was Meera interpreted? That she was devoted to Lord Krishna and she was submerged with him. Possibly she was killed. Many of these Bhakti poets were killed. Tukaram was killed. Naneshwar was killed. Basveshwara from Karnataka was killed because they were talking. There are no evidence, but that's what the people say, because their deaths are mysterious. And Meera is supposed to have submerged with Lord Krishna in the temple. This submerging with the God is not is a kind of a death we don't understand. Mm-hmm. All deaths are suspect. So this all revolt against the caste system of a simpler nature during the medieval period was given a twist by the high caste scholar and converted into a religious devotional movement, which was not. That was basically a revolt against the social system. But in a more contemporary period, a movement against the caste system was started by, number one, Phule in Maharashtra, which was then, after some year, by Ambedkar. In the down south, you have Periyar or Narayan Guru in Kerala, you have Achyutanand in UP, you have Adi movement in Punjab. These are the social movement against the caste system and in favor of Dalit. Human rights movement in their own way started in the 18th century. But I will focus briefly on the Ambedkar. He was an untouchable, got scholarship of King of Baroda, went to USA, did his PhD, did his DSc from London, was barrister at law and all that, and came in early 20s, and he really started the civic right movement. For untouchable to have an entry to the Nasik temple, it was opposed by everybody. Gandhiji supported, and yet the Brahmin priest would not allow. So Ambedkar used the legal code, and finally the untouchable were allowed entry after 10 years. Same is the story with the Mahat. In Mahat, he tried to lodge an agitation to have access to the water because it was a public tank. Burned the manusmriti for the first time in the history of this country. Manusmriti, those pages of manusmriti which degrade the status of untouchable, though they were taken out and they were burned. Ambedkar's basic thesis about the caste system is as follows. His understanding is that caste system is a social organization of the Hindus, but it has a roots in Hindu religious philosophy. Therefore, you have to do something about the reform of Hinduism, the annihilation of caste. It was banned by UP government in 50s and the 60s. There he logically argued that how caste system is against the principle of equality, fraternity and justice, and therefore he argues for a reform of Hinduism. He took a position in 1936 in that book, Annihilation of Caste, that let us take the literature of the India in civilization. You have Buddha, you have Charvaka, you have Jainis, you have Sikh tradition, you have other Bhakti movement. Let us take all this literature and prepare a book which will let down the principle of social behavior. And we can let down the principle of social and religious behavior based on the principle of equality, fraternity and justice. And this was not accepted in 1936. Gandhiji opposed in a way. Now what was Gandhiji's response? Because we have to take Gandhiji simply because we have to give the credit to the Mahatma, because he is the one who at least accepted that there is a problem of untouchability and form an agenda against untouchability, a campaign against untouchability, and brought the issue of Dalit and untouchable on the Congress agenda. But Gandhiji's argument was that untouchability is a sin, casteism is not. It is only in 46 that Gandhiji says that no, casteism is bad. And Ambedkar was a socialist. You look at his State and Minority book, he argued for a state socialism in which nationalization of land, nationalization of industries, key industry, nationalization of life insurance and banking, he supported, but democratic socialist. So his socialistic ideal he draw from Marx, that you must remember. Marx says that the laborer have nothing to lose except the chain of exploitation. But here is a high caste laborer who has to lose something if he want to join hand with the low caste laborer. He has to have an intercaste marriage with him, he has to stay together with him, which is very difficult. Brahmins are superior human beings. They are born out of the mouth of the God, and untouchables are born out of the feet of the God. So they are inferior, we are superior. The concept of being superior and concept of less inferior is a very key concept. This has the roots which can lead to fascism. You being an inferior human being, and therefore you don't have a right. The argument can also be further extended that you don't have a right to live, you can be exterminated the way Hitler did in Germany. You must understand the philosophical root of fascism here. Nietzsche was the fascist philosopher, you know that. Nietzsche's philosophy led to the justification for rise of fascism in Germany. Nietzsche read Manusmriti and he has overwhelming praise for Manusmriti. And he has a long quotation on Manusmriti in praise which Ambedkar gave in that essay. My purpose is to share with you is this, that there are philosophical elements in a Hindu social system and to a certain extent Hindu religious system for fascism. And that you must need to understand. If you only criticize the behavior of some of the people like RSS or Vishwa Hindu Parishad, what determined their thinking, what determined their contemporary exposition about Hindu culture, cultural nationalism or fascist tendency? Because there are philosophical root. They have not come just like that. This concept of being superior, others being inferior, it may be caste or it may be people from other religion, and we being superior is the root for growing fascism. If you look at the Manusmriti, I did not say that. I am not saying anything. You read that Manusmriti. What are the physical punishment? You must see that. For the untouchable, putting molten rava in his hair, cutting his leaf. These are the physical punishment. And extreme intolerance, that if untouchable disobey, he is subject to punishment. The linkages between the growing fascist tendency, interlinkages with the cultural nationalism are to be found in the philosophical element in Hindu social order and to a certain extent religious order. That need to be understood. I think this has not been brought out in my view, as much as they should have been brought out. The untouchable in search of equality have ran away from Hinduism. They went to Christianity, 90% of the Christians are Dalit, they went to Islam, they went to Sikhism, they went to Buddhism. That in the Christianity also, although they got an equality in the religious sphere, they can enter into the churches, but in social sphere they continue to suffer from discrimination by the high caste Christian. So there is a very strong Dalit Christian movement now coming up, arguing for the civil right movement. So religion by itself, conversion by itself does not remove discrimination. Action Aid study on untouchability on Punjab brings out the various form of discrimination within the Sikh, separate residential localities, separate churches, no intercaste marriages. Sikhism has been able to provide religious equality. Anybody can enter into the Gurudwara, but not in terms of social equality. Same is the case with Islam. The battle against communalism and casteism is a common battle.
Y
इन काली सदियों के सर से जब रात का आंचल ढलकेगा।
जब दुख के बादल पिघलेंगे, जब सुख का सागर छलकेगा,
जब अंबर झूम के नाचेगा, जब धरती नगमे गाएगी, वो सुबह कभी तो आएगी, वो सुबह कभी तो